Well, but I come back to a question which was posed yesterday about extensionality axiom. Somebody asked, because I told you that extensionality axiom do not correspond to an instruction or to a program, and in fact, on the other hand, the extensionality axiom of ZF is realized by a proof like term, because every axiom of ZF is realized by a proof like term. But this means that in my mind, the real set theory has become ZF epsilon, in fact. Because the model, by this method, we get a model of ZF epsilon in which we find extensionality equivalence, we get a model of ZF. But the model of ZF does not contain the whole structure. So there is a very interesting structure in the whole model of ZF epsilon, which is probably much richer than the structure you obtain by quotienting by the equivalence, the extensional equivalence. Many sets become equivalent. For instance, the class of sets which are empty is very interesting, has a very interesting structure. And when you quotient into ZF, you get nothing. You get only the empty set. So I finished by considering that the interesting thing was the model of ZF epsilon, and the model of ZF was secondary. So it's the reason why I told. Comment ça marche ce truc? J'appuie. Là je le vois, et là je le vois. Mais ça va s'arrêter toutes les 5 minutes, ça c'est con, ça ne se produisait pas hier.
Je crois que tu ne laissais pas 5 minutes entre les transports.
Ouh! Ça c'est pas vrai. Ça c'est pas vrai. Bon, on va voir. Hein? Well, so I come back to integers. We can define. I have defined a set of integers which I denote by n tilde, because it's not n. It's not in bijection with the integer of the ground model. In general, there are cases when you do not change the integers, but in general, you get non-standard integers. So, oh. Non, mais ça va être embêtant. Hein. There is also something to explain about this. When enforcing, how do you get a model in which you don't change the ordinals, and so you don't change the integers? The general method, for instance, if you define your model by Boolean, by complete Boolean algebra and an ultra filter on the complete Boolean algebra, you do everything in the ground model, and you get your model, you get your forcing model, but it has many non-standard, in this case, it will have many non-standard ordinals and integers. But there is another way. Another way is to take a countable ground model in a big universe and to build your forcing model in the big universe. And then there is a method, there is a way to get, in this case, you can get an end extension of your ground model. But you must take a countable model M And there is a very clever way to obtain this situation. In the case, in the general case of realizability model, it's impossible to do this. You, if you want, you can take a grand model which is countable, but there is no way, and I will show you in examples, there is no way to obtain a realizability model which has the same ordinals. And in general, there is no way to obtain a realizability model which has the same integers. You always have non-standard integers because there are non-standard integers which are definable in the structure N. So you necessarily get new integers. And there is a good interpretation in computer science of this, but I will not enter an economizer d'écran. Well, so you have a situation which is very different with the case of forcing, and you have your grand model, and even you can take it countable, but this does not change anything, and you have your your realizability model, which is much much bigger. The ordinals are non-standard, so it's very difficult to. I cannot make a picture of this. It's you have a non-standard integer here, and the ordinals of n are at inter. between the ordinal, it's not the ordinals of n and then the ordinals of n. It's not at all the case. You have the ordinals are mixed, so it's very difficult to. Well, so what I explained yesterday is I define it's always the technique to define some tricks. In order not to simplify computation, so another trick is to define the quantifier for all x integers and to give it its falsity value, and then to prove once and for all that it is equivalent to what we want, to the fact that for all x, for all integer x, we have a f of x. And then, you have, yes, I told you yesterday this, I don't remember. If I have a function symbol in the grand model of integers into integers, it will give what what you get in this way. You get your function symbol in the realizability model will give you a function from Gimel n to the power k from the type of integers into the type of integers. And in particular, because the true integers are particular elements of Gimel n, it will give you an application of n to the k into Gimel n. And you have a characterization of recursive function. A recursive function, when the function f is recursive in the grand model, you get here an application of integers to two integers. And it's in fact characteristic of recursive function. And uh, And then you can realize, when the function f is recursive, we can realize the fact that for every integer, the value of the function is an integer. When the function is not recursive, it is yet true that for every integer, the value of the function is an integer. In the grand model, it's... But you cannot realize this. So you don't get a program. It's normal, because for a function which is not recursive, it's rather normal that you don't get a program. Then I come to arithmetical formulas. There was the first problem about realizability model, and it is not at all trivial, is to ask, does it give new models of arithmetic? That is, if you can formulate this problem in this way, if you have a true arithmetical formula in the grand model, does it remain true in the realizability model? In fact, it's the case, but it's not at all trivial. So what happens is that, in fact, realizability model cannot change the truth of arithmetical formula. It would have been very interesting if we could find a realizability model which change the value of an arithmetical formula. It's an interesting fact in this theory of classical realizability. Each time you ask a question, like, are arithmetical formula, the truth of arithmetical formula change or not? Each side of each answer is interesting. It's not the case, but if there has been arithmetical formula with the truth value change in a realizability model, it would have been very interesting, because you have in this way a new way to obtain independent formulas of arithmetic, and so it's very interesting. But if it's not the case, and then you get something very interesting also. Since arithmetical formula have the same truth in the grand model and the realizability model, there is, for each arithmetical formula which is true in the grand model, there is a program which realizes it. And it's very interesting. And here it's the case. And precisely, you have the following theorem, which is not trivial. In enforcing model, it's completely trivial. This fact is completely trivial, because the integers are not changed. But here, you have the following theorem. If you have an arithmetical formula with f, there is something interesting here. You take for f any function, not necessarily recursive. Take for f any function from integers to integers. And look, suppose that in the grand model you have this. You take a function from integers into booleans, for example, to be. You take f from integers into boolean, any function. And consider this formula, and suppose it is true in M. Then there is a proof-like term which realizes this. A proof-like term, and it's interesting to remark that this proof-like term is independent of f. It depends only on k, on the number of inversion of quantifier. There is a proof-like term which realizes this, which is stronger. The universal quantifier are restricted to the type of integer, so this formula is stronger than expected, because we should expect this. But this is stronger because it's, you are saying that it is true not only for integers, but also for a bigger set. That may look, that may seem very strange, because f is any function. But there is something rather subtle here. You need here, when you write different from zero, in m it's the same thing than m. When you say that f of x is different from zero, in the grand model, it's the same thing, because f can take only value 0, 1. But in the realizability model, this formula is much weaker than this one. To be different from zero, it's not at all to be equal to one, because Gimel 2 is very different, very bigger than 0, 1. So you have something which is rather which weaker, and you get this if the function f is recursive, because in this case, if the function f is recursive and if you put integer here, you get what you get, a program which realize what which realize the arithmetical formula. Then you obtain that every arithmetical formula which is true in M, but you have a much more general theorem in this way. What you prove is this, and the program you get, which is not at all trivial, this program is very intricate and more complicated with when k increase. So you get you get the fact that you don't change the truth of arithmetical formula. A more general problem would be, do you change the truth of formula, of constructible sets? That is, if you have a formula restricted to constructible sets, which is true in the grand model, is it true in the realizability model? This is this was a big problem, because it would, and each side would be interesting for the reason I. But it was very long to solve this, but I solved this 3 months ago, in fact, and. You have the fact that you don't change the truth in the constructible set. In fact, you have this situation in, and it's not at all trivial. All these things are completely trivial in forcing, and they are not at all trivial in the general case. You have the following situation: you take your ground model M, you take your realizability model N, and then what you get, you look at the constructible sets in N, L of N, and you have the fact that L of N is an elementary extension of the L of M. The ordinals are completely different, but L of M embeds elementary in L of N, and so the truth is not changed. In fact, M, the wall of M, embeds elementary in N in the same way. Not in N, because they are not elementary equivalent. The fact is that you have call it M prime. You have N, which is bigger. You have N. And you have a subclass of N, which is transitive, with the same ordinals and so on, which is an elementary extension of M. And so the L of N is certainly an elementary extension. It's a method to prove this. It's the result. So, as I told you, this may seem a little bit disappointing, because if we look for independence result, for instance, we would have been pleased to obtain independent result for sigma 1, 2 and pi 1, 2 formulas, which is impossible with forcing by a theorem of Schoenfield. And it's the same situation. You will not get independence result for such formulas because of this situation. But on the other hand, we get something very interesting, which is for every true sigma 1, 3 formula in the grand model, there is a program which realizes it. And it's very, very, it's very, very complicated to get such a program, and very interesting to look at it. For the moment, I am not able to understand this. There is much work to be done in this direction. So the theorem is that any true sigma 1, 3 formula is realized by a closed lambda term with called CC. So now I will give some example of realizability model. Enormous variety, because even forcing models are many forcing models which have been studied in details, and but the notion of realizability model is much more general, and so you have so what I have done up to now is to look at particular. For instance, you have a way to get a big lot of realizability model. It's by in forcing, you have a standard method, which is iterated forcing. You take a model, you force with a certain set of conditions, you get a new model, and then in this new model, you take a certain set of conditions, and you force with it, and you get a new model, again, a bigger model. And the second model can be obtained in one step by a set of conditions which is built with in certain good in some way, and in this way we can build new sets of conditions which are interesting. You have the same situation here, and but in much interesting way, because look, you take M, your model M. In each, you take a realizability algebra A. You get a model N, and then you can say, "Oh, I take a new realizability algebra here, and I iterate." But simply take a set of conditions in the model, in the model of ZF you get from N. Take simply a set of conditions, and what I used was a set of conditions. Well, in this case, when you, if you take a set of conditions, you have what I call N prime in it, which is the quotient of N, which is a model of ZF. In this, you can take a set of conditions C, and you will get some new model. In fact, an interesting method is to take a set of conditions. For instance, you can take a set of conditions which destroy a cardinal here. But what the interesting thing to do is, in this way we get very interesting realizability algebra, is to destroy, to work directly in N, so all the whole theory of forcing is not usable because, but it works almost in the same way. Directly in N, you take something which destroys a set in N, which is not, for example, a set, what should I take? An example which is very interesting is to destroy Gimel of P, of the set of stack. You take the set of stack, the Gimel of the set of stack, and you destroy it, you make it countable in the usual way. And in this way, you get a new realizability model. It's not exactly forcing, because in forcing, you must use sets. And this is not a set. Every element of this is, empty, in fact. So, but in this way, you get very interesting algebra here, a very interesting algebra here. I will not explain this here, but just to say that you have an infinity of methods possible to get realizability algebra. So, I will consider two kinds of examples, but perhaps one, only one, because I don't know if I will have time to consider the second. The first is what I call standard realizability algebra, which are very interesting because you take an algebra which the terms are built, are terms of, are real terms. So the terms of a standard realizability algebra is a real program because it is written. It is the term are built with, I will explain this, but the term are built with the combinators and so on. So you have real programs in it. The second example, which I'm not sure to explain, is a fact, a very interesting fact, which has been found by Thomas Erhard, and also by Thomas Treacher, that the usual models of lambda calculus, which are the Scott domain, the stable model, the hypercoherence models, and so on, which are combinatory algebras, as is well known, are in fact realizability algebras. So you can you can enrich the structure of this model in a way such as to get a realizability algebra, so that every model of lambda calculus will give realizability algebra, and so will give a model of set theory, a realizability model of set theory. And they have very interesting properties, special properties, because they are closer to forcing models. The standard realizability algebra are very far from forcing, and this one are much closer to forcing model. So I come to the first example. What I call a standard realizability algebra is the fact that you build terms, the set of terms, is a real term, which is built with the elementary combinator and a new one, which I call sigma, the second sigma of the Greek alphabet. So we build terms with these combinators by application. And you take new symbol k, and you see you take you define you have this recursive definition of term by application. If xi and eta are terms, xi eta is a term with parentheses, and you define stack by pushing a term on a stack, and then you define continuation by taking the symbol k. K is a symbol, and then you put a stack behind it, and you enclose it in brackets if you want. It's not necessary at all, in fact. And the process is simply an ordered pair with a term and a stack. So the operation of application, push, continuation, and process are trivial because they are defined in the structure, immediately defined inside the structure. This model will be interesting because the objects of the realizability algebra are real programs, in fact. If we must say how to use the new symbol sigma, so you define the preorder by applying exactly the rule, the rule which have been already given for the rule of execution of the combinator and application, and the new combinator sigma, it's like a quote in Lisp, for example. It operates like a quote in Lisp, which means that sigma applied to xi and eta to two give to xi an argument which is a number, an integer. It's the integer associated with eta in a fixed enumeration of terms. You have a countable set of terms, and you take an enumeration not necessarily recursive. If it is not recursive, you will say, oh, if you take an enumeration which is not recursive, you don't obtain programs. It's not true. It's not true because you have programs, for example, which expect a value from outside. Many programs, every network program, in some way, expect value from outside. So, sigma you may have an oracle which is from outside. So you don't know, what value it will give to eta. The only condition is that it does not change in time. With the same term, you always get the same integer. You can define. In Lisp, you have an instruction like this, which is quote, which transform a program, which take a term and transform it in a text, into a text, which is exactly the same thing, almost the same thing as an integer. In Lisp, you have also an inverse instruction, which is eval, which take a text, and if it is possible, transform it, execute it. It's a very dangerous instruction. You cannot put it here so I will not explain why, but if you think about, you may understand why. It's possible to use instruction like eval, but with much, much precaution. And now you take for bottom any set of processes which is closed by reverse execution. And the proof like terms are simply the terms you obtain by application and the seven combinators. So you have the. So the only variable thing in a standard realizability algebra, the only variable thing seems to be bottom, the set of processes. And perhaps the proof like term also, because you can take exactly the proof like term generated by the combinator and application, and then there is only one set, but you can take a bigger set closed by application also. And now with such algebra, we can realize dependent choice. Dependent choice is true in the model, in the realizability model, in such a realizability model. In fact, what we realize is the following. You take any formula of ZF epsilon, you take any formula of ZF epsilon, and then you can define in the ground model, M, you can define a function symbol with the following property. If there is a y so such as fxy, then there is an integer, f has two argument symbol. There is an integer such that you have f of x and f of n and x. So the symbol f is not exactly a choice function, but almost a choice function, because you make a choice into a sequence. You transform any choice into a choice into a sequence. And since the integers are well ordered, you can take the first integer for which works in this sequence, and so you transform. A consequence of this formula is that you can find a function phi, which is f of nx for the first n, such that this is true, if there is one. If there is not, you take zero, you take anything. And then you have, in fact, the axiom of what seems to be the full axiom of choice, but which is not. You have this. There are two remarks to be done here. First, the phi you write here is not of the same nature of f. F is a function symbol, phi is not. F has been defined in M. It's impossible to find a unary function symbol in M such that you can realize this. But nevertheless, you get a choice function. So you have a sort of choice. Why this axiom is not the usual choice? Because it's the function phi doesn't work with the model of ZF, because it is not in general and almost never compatible with extensionality. So if you change, for instance, if suppose x is some set which is empty, you will obtain phi of x, which depends of x, and if you take another empty set here, you will obtain here another set, which has nothing to do with the first one. And so you cannot use it to obtain the axiom of choice in your model of ZF. So I call this axiom the non-extensional choice. It is a choice in ZF epsilon, but not in ZF. And this is much weaker than choice, because we will see that we have models of this axiom in which R is not well ordered. You cannot prove the well ordering of R with this axiom, so it you see that it is not at all choice. And but a consequence of this axiom is dependent choice. A trivial consequence. So it implies the dependent choice, and it's trivial. You simply have, suppose you, for all x, you have a y. So you take your function phi, and you iterate your function phi on a zero, and you get a sequence ai, such that f of ai, ai plus one. So you get immediately dependent choice with this axiom. Here is the proof, and the lambda term which realizes my first formula with the function symbol f. I take the converse form, and you obtain this. There is a call CC in it. There is a proof. The proof is very simple, but I don't detail it. Ah, why I come back to the Boolean, why do I come back here to the Boolean algebra Gimel 2? Yes, it's, I have told you everything which is on this slide. Ah, not this. Not this. There is. Yeah, I obtained this also recently. It's first. It's a lemma. There is always your algebra. The algebra Gimel 2, which is very important in the model, maybe anything. I found a model. You can find a realizability model in which this algebra is finite, has four elements, for example. It's two elements, any forcing in the forcing models are the model in which Gimel 2 is equal to 2. But you can have Gimel 2 with four elements, with any 2 to the n element, or atomic, or atomless, and so on. But a theorem, which is found very recently, is that there is always at least one. It may be not well orderable, so but there is always at least one ultrafilter on Gimel 2, and it was with this ultrafilter, which is a very which is definable in the model n epsilon. In the model n of ZF epsilon, and it's a very interesting object of the model, and I used it in order to prove what I told you already, the fact that the situation that you have a submodel of n, which is an elementary extension of the ground model. It's a lemma, an important lemma in this proof. Well, yes, I come back to Gimel 2 because Gimel 2, when you have a realizability algebra, a standard realizability algebra, the algebra Gimel 2 is not, maybe not well orderable, maybe very strange, but it has a remarkable property that to have a countable dense subset, which is rather surprising. You have a countable dense subset. You can realize by using your instruction quote, you can realize the following thing. What does it mean? There is a function symbol in M, in the ground model, from the integers into 2, and this function is not recursive, not at all. You will see from its definition. There is a function from n into 2 which has the following property. For all x different from 0 in the algebra, there is an integer such that delta n is different from zero and less than x. So it exactly means that the object delta n, which belongs to Gimel 2, are dense in the algebra, because you can find for every object, for every element of your Boolean algebra which is different from zero, you can find a delta n with n integers which is different from zero and less than x. So you have the, and it's realized by using this instruction. Here I recall the execution rule of the instruction, which transform a term into an integer, the numeral of this integer, the number of this term in some fixed enumeration of terms. And the definition of delta in the grand model is the following, which is not at all recursive. It says that delta of an integer, delta is defined to be the values of delta are 0 or 1. And you say that delta g is 0 if and only if the term of number g realizes bottom. So it's a definition. And in general, it's almost never recursive. And since it is not delta, since it is an application from n into 2, in the realizability model, it is an application of Gimel n into Gimel 2. So there is an application of this is an application of the integers into Gimel 2. And you see here that it is not recursive because Gimel 2 is big. And you must have values of delta which are different from 0 and 1 because the values of delta are dense in Gimel 2. So you see that delta has no chance to be recursive. And the result of this, so it's a proof. The proof is not difficult. Well, bon, I don't detail it. So it's interesting to look at the proof because you see that it is not long. It's a complete proof is here, so you see. If you want, you can look at it. I will put the slide on some site. I don't know which. And you see the result of this is the following. The result of this is that you find an application in your realizability model. You find of into R into you find an injective application of Gimel 2 into the subset of n. Simply, you take for if you have an element A of Gimel 2, you take phi of A to be the set of integers for which delta n is less than A. Take A different from zero. And by the fact that the delta n are dense in the algebra, you find that phi is trivially an injection. So you have injected a set which elements of which are empty. Gimel 2, all elements of Gimel 2 are empty. So the Gimel 2 is not at all embedded in the model of ZF. Yeah, when you collapse extensionally in order to get your model of ZF, Gimel 2 collapses to one element. Two elements, because there is one element which is not empty, which is one, and all other elements by collapsing Gimel 2 gives 0, 1, and Gimel n gives n, and n tilde gives n also. Gimel n and l tilde give the same result by collapsing into the by extensionality. But you have found an injection of Gimel 2 into P of n, and what you will see is that Gimel 2 is a very strange set. In the case of realizability, standard realizability algebra, Gimel 2 is a very strange set, and so we will get very strange sets in P of n. And in this way, we see that P of n is not well ordered. It has very a lot of different cardinality in it. It has the power of the continuum set of different cardinality, and an horrible. It's an horrible situation. In the model of ZF, R. Will have very strange properties, and in particular, it is not well orderable. Well, I explain now how I obtain this. So I define Gimel n for each integer n, which is trivial. You have n. You take n to be in the grand model. You take this. Yes, I define this. You can say it's exactly the definition of n. But I remember that I take the successor to be the singleton. So I must define this object. And you have a function symbol n to Gimel n and so on. And you define for a new function symbol m less than n with zero value 0 and 1. And you have some trivialities. You have an. When you define such thing, in integers, you have the relation, the binary relation of the ordering binary relation. You cannot extend directly a relation. You can extend a function. So you define, you transform your binary relation into a function, into 0, 1. You take m equals n equal 1 if it is true and 0 if it is false. And then you get what you get in this way. You transform everything into a function in the grand model because you have this marvelous tool that every function in the grand model becomes a function in the realizability model. So it's very useful thing. So what you get now, this function is an application of Gimel n to the square into Gimel 2. And you can look at the relation, at this relation into, it's a binary relation into Gimel n. It's an order relation, a strict order relation, but here it is total, here it is not total at all. And it is total on the subset of integers because you get here you get the usual relation on the integers of the realizability model because this function is trivially recursive. Well, so I explain how to inject Gimel n into R. I explain how to inject Gimel 2 into R. The function I define here, you define an injection of Gimel 2 into R in this way, and then by induction on F, you define an injection of Gimel 2 to the N into R, but Gimel 2 to the N is exactly Gimel, because you have the property in general, you have the property that Gimel A times B is equal to isomorphic to, so you can remember this. It's not at all true for sum, for example, but for product is trivially true. And so Gimel 2 to the n is equipotent with Gimel 2 to the n. And so you have an injection of Gimel n, because n is less than 2 to the n for every n. So you have an injection of Gimel n into R for every n, integer n, for every integer n. But why I must restrict here to integers, not to Gimel, because I define this function by induction on integers. So on Gimel n, you don't have induction. Here you have only an integer. So it's true only on integer. And so you have an injection, you have very strange subset of R, which are the image of Gimel n. Why are they very strange? Because we will now define a special realizability algebra by choosing the set bottom in such a way that in the realizability model, Gimel 2 is infinite, it will be atomless, in fact. So it will be infinite. And the cardinals of Gimel n, of the Gimel n, form a strictly increasing sequence, which means that there is no surjection of Gimel n onto Gimel n plus 1. So if you look at the image, by F, you obtain a sequence of subset of R, which are increasing in cardinal. Not so strange. But it becomes much more strange with this remark. The remark is that Gimel n times Gimel n is equipotent, is in fact exactly the same object, that Gimel mn. So what you obtain is that you have a very strange family of subset of R, the image of Gimel n, you call it xn, which is a subset of R. You have, they are increasing in cardinal, strictly increasing, and xm times xn is equipotent to xmn, which is I've never seen such a situation. And a sequence of infinite set with the property which are strictly increasing in cardinal. And so for instance, you have x2, which is strictly less than x2 to the square, which is equal, which is the same as x4. So this means that R is not well ordered because you have an infinite subset of R which is not equipotent to its square. Well, but if you look at, you see, for instance, so you have the following inequality, which is very interesting. And so you have x5, x6, x7. For example, it's an example. You have a strictly increasing sequence of cardinals, and you have the cardinal of x, which is strictly less. This is very strange. And for every integer, it's true. So you have a situation which had never been obtained. And with forcing, you have, and you also have dependent choice. In fact, so you can make an usual analysis and so on. So the set of reals has the usual property which are necessary in order to do analysis. But we see that the set of subset of R is very, very strange. I think it's not, I am practically sure it's not obtainable. Such situation is not obtainable by forcing. And in fact, it's not finished. The subset of R has many, many different properties which with very strange, the number of, you have an increasing sequence in of subset of R, which is ordered by the continuum. So it's a very, which is very interesting, is that we obtain this very strange situation in R with the simplest possible realizability model. So my opinion is that the axiom of choice is very far from the truth. Because saying that the axiom of choice is true in this is very not plausible. Well, so I explain the model in which I obtain this realizability model. In which I obtain this, il est. Je ne sais plus où j'en suis. Pardon? Ah, une demi-heure. Ah bon? Oh bon. Ça va alors. So I now explain which model I take. I told you it's the simplest possible model. Standard model. Ah, a remark. If in such model, if Gimmel, in any standard realizability model, if Gimmel 2 is non-trivial, then there is a non-standard integer in the model N. The proof is very simple. You take any element, since Gimmel 2 is not trivial, there is some A which is different from 0, 1, and since the delta of n are dense in Gimmel 2, you obtain an integer such that delta of n is different from 0, unless n delta of n is less than a, so delta of n is different from 1. So delta of n is different from 0 and 1, but n must be non-standard because delta m, if m is standard, since delta m is an extension of the definition in the ground model, if m is standard, delta m is equal to 0 or 1. So there is necessarily a non-standard integer. In fact, there is a definable non-standard integer, but maybe not. So the model cannot be a forcing model. And now I define the simplest non-trivial realizability model in this way. You take an enumeration of the empty stacks of the constant, which are the empty stacks. And because stack, the stacks are built from the empty stack, pi of n, and you push terms on them. So any stack is of the form C1, C2, Ck and some empty stack pi of n. Take an enumeration of the empty stack and a corresponding enumeration of the proof-like term. So you have not necessarily recursive, in fact. And then you define the thread of number n, which is the set of process you obtain by execution from, you start with the proof like term number n with the empty stack number n, and you execute this. You obtain a sequence of process, which I call the thread with number n, because it's like a thread, in fact. And you see that in the thread of number n, the only stack constant which appear is necessarily pi n. And then you define bottom. You define bottom. What you need for bottom? You need bottom to be closed by inverse execution. And for every proof like term, you need to have a stack such that theta star pi is not in bottom. So you take a proof like term theta n, and you decide that for the empty stack pi n, it is not in bottom. So it's the simplest possible way to have the property of coherence, you know. And then you define bottom by saying that the complement of bottom is the union of all threads. You obtain exactly the smallest complement of bottom, so you obtain the biggest bottom. Because the complement of bottom is the less possible if you define it in this way. So you see that a process is in bottom if it never appears in any thread. You can think of this model by saying you have a boot. You know, a thread, what is the thread number n? This is the boot situation, and you execute this. You can imagine that pi n, there is no information in pi n because it is a constant. So all the information is here. You can understand that theta n is an operating system, which may be very simple or very complicated. And then you boot with this operating system by giving to it an empty stack. It's exactly the case in a real operating system. You boot, you have your operating system in general on the hard disk, and you boot it by giving it nothing, and it, because itself it put on the it creates itself its own environment by pushing on the stack many programs, drivers, and so on. So. So this has an interpretation in real informatics. You see that a term realizes the false if it never appears in head position, in any thread. You never find it in head position. And in the model of thread, we have two properties which have very important consequences in the model, which are the following. They are very simple to prove. They are very simple properties which have big consequences. There is a proof-like term such that for any two different terms, it's impossible that there is a proof like term omega, such that for it's impossible that omega k by xi is in realized bottom, and that one of these two terms realized bottom, omega k by xi it's impossible that none of them don't realize bottom. One of them necessarily realizes bottom if xi is different for xi prime. It's completely trivial. If you take for omega the usual loop, infinite loop, lambda xxx applies to lambda xxx, because you see that, why? Where is the... Why is it true? For a very simple reason. Consider, suppose that omega do not realize bottom, and that omega k pi c prime do not realize bottom. So you have a stack, omega k pi psi equal star something rho, which is not in bottom, so it appears in some thread. But this thread, you know which is this thread because you have a stack here. So you, the number of this thread is necessarily the number of the constant of this stack, the end of this stack. And here you have, for a prime, which also appears. But if you execute these two terms, what do you get? You get omega and omega . So these two processes would be in the same thread because the pi is the same. And so the constant is the same. It's impossible because when you arrive here in a thread, you stop because omega loops infinitely. So you stop on one of these two possibilities. But since the stack is not the same here because of xi and xi prime, it's impossible you get this in the same thread. It's completely trivial. The same proof, a little bit different, but the same kind of proof shows that you have this property. If you have three distinct terms, one of these three terms necessarily realizes bottom, alpha, zeta 0, zeta 1, zeta 2. If the zeta 0, zeta 1, zeta 2 are distinct terms, one of these three, for every alpha and pi, one of these three terms necessarily does not appear. It's very trivial to the same kind of proof will show this. A little more subtle, but not, not much. And these two properties has big consequences. The consequence of one. Now I forget the thread model and simply I consider any realizability model which has the property one. And necessarily in N, Gimel 2 is not countable. And necessarily there is no surjection from Gimel N onto Gimel N if M is strictly less than N. So you see that the property 1 gives you exactly the situation I needed to obtain this strange sequence of subset of R. So I obtain a sequence of infinite subset of R such that their cardinal are strictly increasing and with this very strange property. So the dependent choice is true, but R is not. So here is exactly the example I have given you. I'm telling that these relative consistency results are not obtainable by forcing. In fact, certainly I cannot prove this. So I cannot be absolutely sure that it's impossible to that. But I ask some competent men, who told me that it was, in particular, John Truth, who told me that the difficulty for him was the fact that there are subset of R, you have dependent choice, and you have subset of R. And then it's not. So the second property, so I had two properties here, the first one and the second one, has also very strange consequences. So if you have a realizability model which satisfies property 2, then Gimel 2 is atomless. And you look for every element A and B of Gimel 2, you look at the ideal A Gimel 2, which is the set of subset of A in your Boolean algebra, the set of elements strict, less than A. Well, I call it, I write it A Gimel 2, which means all the elements of the form AX for X in Gimel 2, which is a set of sub-elements of A Gimel 2, by definition, is a set of A of AX for X Gimel 2. One must be very careful. I have made many errors by writing such thing. One must be very careful. Here there is no problem, but in other situation you must be very careful when you work in ZF epsilon not to use extensionality by it's very difficult not to use extensionality. For instance, you write this in ZF epsilon, this means you must, there is no meaning for this unless you have exactly defined the function symbol bracket, accolade, je ne sais plus comment on dit. Because there are many sets with these elements. So you cannot write equals something which is not exactly defined. But this means any, in fact, here, you take any set. It's the difficulty in working with this model is the fact that you need to work in ZF epsilon and you must not use extensionality. It's very difficult to not to use extensionality by inadvertence. So if I have property 2, Gimel 2 is an atomless Boolean algebra. If you take disjoint element of Gimel 2, of your algebra, there are of incomparable cardinality. A Gimel 2, there is no surjection of A Gimel 2 onto B Gimel 2, and conversely. And if A is strictly less than B, the cardinal of A is strictly less than the cardinal of B. So if you look at your injection of Gimel 2 into R, what do you get? You obtain a Boolean algebra of infinite subset of R, such that for disjoint subset of this algebra, the cardinal are not comparable. And for if X is strictly contained in Y in this algebra, the cardinal of X is strictly less than the cardinal of Y. So what is strange is that the order in the Boolean algebra is defined by the cardinality. X is strictly less than Y if and only if the cardinal of X is the cardinal of Y. So you have a Boolean algebra in R, in which, of subset of R, in which the order in the Boolean, the inclusion, in fact, is exactly the order, the cardinality order, which is very, also very strange. Well, here are the proofs. You see, I simply show here that Gimel 2 is not equipotent with Gimel 4, which is, once you, you see that the proof on two slides. You need two slides, it's not complicated. Well, I have finished with this example. I have 10 minutes, I suppose. And I come to a completely different example, which is the the model, the realizability model we obtain with denotation, with a domain with denotational semantics. It's a rather interesting story, in fact, because you look. In you have in 62, Cohen discovered the method of forcing, and then immediately after, Dana Scott and Wopenka and Solovey found that you can always take as a set of conditions, you can take a complete Boolean algebra and you can present forcing from a complete Boolean algebra. It's very useful for some proofs. And it was Schoenfield, in fact, who found the method, the presentation we generally used in forcing. So the Schoenfield presentation and the Scott and Solo and Wopenka Solovey, the Boolean presentation, have their own advantage. And then Dana Scott became a computer scientist, and 10 years later, he defined models of lambda calculus by means of complete lattices. So, certainly, he remembered complete Boolean algebra because complete lattices and complete Boolean algebra are very similar structure. And now, it's very interesting that we can complete this story and close the loop, because if you take a complete lattice, you don't have a Boolean, a forcing model, but you have a realizability model. Because in general, if you start with a model of lambda calculus, in general, not always, but there is a general method in order to give it a structure of realizability algebra, and then you obtain a model of ZF from this realizability algebra. So I will explain this on a special model of lambda calculus. So there are many different models of lambda calculus, and all this model, you have the usual definition of the combinators K and S, and if you want B, C, and in the lambda calculus model, you can take K and S because it's the same thing. Everything you have beta equivalence, so it's not necessary to take this special combinator, you can take K and S, it's exactly the same thing. So you have the combinators which are defined and the operation of application. So if you want to obtain a realizability algebra, you need to define some more things, which are the stacks and the process and the combinator called CC and continuation and the operation of continuation and the three operation push. The operation push and process. the application is already defined. And there is a remarkably simple way to do this, which was found by Thomas Erhard, and the construction of TAC also was found by Thomas Streicher very long ago. I don't remember. yes. So, and there is also a natural way to define proof-like terms. So you get, for free, if you use this method, you get from many models of lambda calculus, you have a much richer structure, and you get in this way a realizability algebra and a model of the theory. So I will give you one example. The simplest example is the Scott model, the Scott domain. But the Scott domain has a special property to have a parallel OR. And we have seen that if in our realizability algebra we have a parallel OR, the model you obtain is a forcing model. So I don't want this. So I must take a little bit more complicated model, which is the simplest coherent model of lambda calculus. I remember you how to build it. Well, perhaps I will do, perhaps I can suppose, you know. Because so you define the form of what is called the web, the set of formula from a fixed symbol O, which is, we can think it as the false, and by iterating the operation from if alpha is a formula and A a finite set of formula, then A implies alpha is a formula, and you identify in order to have the property of extensionality in the model, you need to identify the empty set implies O with O. So you define the formulas in this way, and each formula has the form A1AK. A1AK are finite set of formulas, implies O. And you can put empty here, if you want, because it's the same. And you define the truth value of a formula in the usual way. You say that if a formula alpha has a truth value 1, if there is an element in A1 AK which has a value 0. Well, this is simply the usual definition of truth value. And then you define the compatibility of formulas. So you define the meet, some meet between formula in this way. And then you define the web because you want to restrict the set to, in the Girard presentation, you have click, and I prefer to present this as anti-chain, but it's the same thing. Click are a finite set with compatible elements, and anti-chain are finite set with incompatible elements, which is almost the same thing because it's the contrary. So you do it very quickly because suppose you have some idea about this. So you define the subset of F, which is called the web. Nothing to do with the web. By saying that a formula is in W if A1 AK are anti-chain. And an anti-chain are defined recursively. An anti-chain means that if beta and gamma are AI is an anti-chain, if beta and gamma are in AI and different, they are incompatible, so that their meet is not in the web. So it's recursive definition of the web. Perhaps, so now the, you have the definition of the term. Now I come to the realizability algebra. The realizability algebra is defined in the following way. You take for lambda, for the set of terms, the set of antichain of W, that is every subset of W, which is in which, if alpha and beta are in this set and compatible, they are necessarily equal. And you can define application in this way, so application with multiple arguments. And all this need checking, but it's not difficult. You can define I, K, C, W, B. In fact, you need simply to define K and S, but you can define I, K, C, and B. It's a very well-known definition. And the set of stack. So here, something new is the set of stack. A stack is a filter in W. That means that a subset of W in which every couple of elements are compatible, so it's a converse of terms, and which is a terminal segment of W. Everything which is greater than an element of W is greater than an element of pi is also in pi. And you define push here. And we see there is a remark which make perhaps the things more intuitive. You can identify the stack with the infinite sequence of terms. You can define the terms as the stacks as being infinite sequence of terms. So the operation of push is simply to put a term in front of the stack, and you obtain a new infinite sequence. Interesting, how do you define the continuation and call CC? This is new. The definition of Thomas, Era, are the following. If you take a stack, you obtain a term by taking this set, so the set of formula of this form. So it's and cool CC, you can take for cool CC. Yes, this is the definition. I will not check this because no time. So you have a definition, a very simple definition of cool CC, and everything works. For what? And then you obtain that you don't. First, the first thing is that you don't have. You don't have a parallel OR, which is very well known in this model. And so the model of ZF you obtain is not a forcing model. Thomas Treacher told me, he has shown that he satisfies the dependent choice. I never understood this proof, so perhaps he will explain it someday. And the problem, does this model satisfy the axiom of choice? I don't know. Nobody knows. It's a very interesting problem. I suppose not. My guess is not, but it would be. Each time you have a question, each answer is interesting. If you. It would be very interesting to obtain the axiom of choice. Very, very interesting, because I don't have. I never got a realizability model which satisfies the axiom of choice. So I would like to get one. And the final remark I can do is that you have the very interesting properties of this model. Perhaps I will explain it on the blackboard. Is that if you have a sequence of proof-like terms, any sequence theta n of proof-like term, you can find a proof-like term such that theta n is equivalent to theta. You can find a proof-like term t theta such that theta n is equivalent to theta applies to n, to the integer n. Every sequence of proof-like term is the value of is given. It means that everything is recursive in this. Every sequence is recursive in this model. Every sequence of proof-like term is given by a term. The consequence of this, for instance, is the fact that there is an omega model. The realizability model. There is a realizability model of, in this case, in which the integers are not changed. You have an omega model, which a realizability model, which is an omega model. You are much nearer to forcing model. Forcing model are always omega model, and here we can obtain not. You cannot preserve ordinals, but we can preserve integers. So it's a very interesting case. We don't know much about this model, like even for other models, in fact. So there is much things to be done in this theory. And I can stop here.
You have not mentioned Cohen's proof of the independence of the axiom of choice.
Cohen's proof?
Cohen's proof.
Yes.
Which is a modification of forcing using groups of permutations.
Yes, yes. It's very well known. It's very, very old thing, very well known, very standard. Yes, it's.
I have not noticed any permutations.
No, no, no. There is not at all the same thing. You have, there, in a sense, you have a new proof of the independence of axiom of choice. But if it was simply a new proof of the independence of choice, well, but it's interesting that we get properties of subset of R which are very strange. There is no use of, there is nothing about permutation here. It's not at all the same method, not at all. You directly obtain. In forcing, you always obtain choice. And then if you want to, if you want model without choice, you need to restrict your models to, with some kind, in general, with permutation, using permutation. Here, you obtain the negation of choice directly.
Any other questions?
Can we say in some sense that when you're working in N, you're investigating the property of a new kind of proof system, the one related to the models, the richer model you consider?
J'ai pas bien compris ce que tu dis. Si tu peux parler plus fort.
You first said that. If you're provable in ZF, then you are realizable. But then you're only working in N. So, and you have strange results in N by reasoning.
Yes, but N is arbitrary.
So, what is the proof system associated to reasoning in N? So, can we say.
Oh, it's not a proof system. It's everything is semantic. It's like forcing. If you ask, what is the proof system in forcing, you will have something. Terrible. It's semantic. You say, I have a method in order to.
There is a proof system.
Yes, there is. If you want absolutely to get a proof system, you will get one. But I don't want certainly not, because it will be horrible. It will be horrible. So exactly, you don't have a proof system for realizability, clean realizability, for instance, because it's semantic. you t'es pas d'accord? It's a semantic thing.
It seems to me that at least for the thread model, it seems to me that at least for the thread model, the big new thing is that you can have proof of false in some sense.
Proof of false? No.
Because in your language, you can you have delta realizing so you can use but
no a proof like term never realize false. Delta don't realize false.
Yes, but you have delta in your language, and it does not realize false because you are able to find a stack.
Yes.
Which against which it does not go to the bottom.
Yes.
So
it's an empty stack, in fact.
Yes, but in some sense you have command. If we reason in a proof system with terms, command, and stack, you have a lot of commands of type bottom. You have a lot of commands of
command. Term, like a term, what you call command is...
Processes are proof, not as realizer, but as proof terms. You have a lot of processes,
maybe,
of closed processes in the empty context, but it's done in such a way that you cannot have a proof of false.
Yes.
So, which contradicts the usual view that the processes can be interpreted as a bottom type. So by making a distinction between the set of processes on the term, you can have processes without having proof of false, which is remarkable.
Thank you, but I don't understand exactly what you mean.
It just consists of non-proof-like terms, just this quasi-falsity. That's the point.
Yes.
I don't really understand the yes, but perhaps we discuss more.
Yes, I think maybe. Mm-hmm. So there is
last question.
Ask you, could there be a way to control determinacy property in realizability models? Determinacy.
The problem with big cardinals. Determinacy implies big cardinals in some submodels and so on. Oh yes. The problem with big cardinals, in fact, these models are not very compatible with big cardinals. No, perhaps you can define big, for example, measurable cardinals in them. Determinacy, perhaps there is a program. Perhaps, yes, it was certainly. I don't see the method in order to get it, but it's open. It's an open question, yes.
Should be.
It may be rather difficult to.
Okay. So we can discuss that offline. Let's thank Jean-Louis again.
Thank you.